complex figure, we'll examine the menstrual cycle. And the menstrual cycle is really the combination of the ovarian cycle as well as what happens with the lining of the uterine wall. Now, on the left here, we have basically all of folliculogenesis over here. And folliculogenesis is the nearly year-long process that culminates in ovulation of the egg. Now, it begins with primordial follicles that are recruited with each cycle of folliculogenesis. Post-puberty, those small groups, a dozen or so, a couple dozen or so primordial follicles are recruited to become primary follicles. Those primaries will transition to secondary follicles, where the granulosa cells are dividing and becoming multi-layered. The theca cells will adhere to the outside of this, adding to this growing follicle. It will develop an antrum, that's called an antral secondary follicle. This fluid-filled space will develop. And finally, we'll end up with recruitable antral secondary follicles. Recruitable meaning they are now sensitive to the pituitary gonadotropins, FSH and LH, to enter the ovarian cycle, this 28-day cycle. And so we have these antral secondary follicles that are growing in response to that FSH, and they're producing a significant amount of estrogen as well as some inhibin. And that estrogen and inhibin will feed back negatively on the FSH. That sounds counterintuitive. However, the falling FSH means that only the most FSH-sensitive follicle will make it to full development. Remember, we need to get down from a dozen or more of these secondary follicles to a single dominant follicle. And again, the fallen FSH is what helps promote that. We will have hormonal changes at the middle of the cycle here that will result in ovulation of the egg. And then we enter the luteal phase, the second half of this ovarian cycle, where the leftover follicle, if you will be converted to the corpus luteum. The corpus luteum is also an endocrine structure, although it's going to be dominant in producing progesterone, while estrogen becomes a little less dominant. And so we'll see that that actually helps support maintenance of that uterine lining for that ovulated egg, if it becomes fertilized, to implant in that wall. Now, over here on the right, we're basically taking this full 28-day cycle and we're just overlaying it with all of these other events that are helping to control it, as well as the uterine lining that's being controlled by some of these hormones as well. And so here again, we have our ovulation in the middle, follicular phase before, luteal phase after. And one important thing to point out is that at the end of this ovarian cycle, it's a loop. We come back and we will initiate the start of another cycle. We come right back to recruiting the next batch of secondary antral follicles to enter the follicular phase. Now, at the top here, we have our GnRH pulse frequency. That's the hypothalamus helping to control the anterior pituitary hormones, FSH and LH. The ovarian hormones being controlled largely by the FSH and LH. And then, of course, the uterine lining down here at the bottom, largely being controlled by the ovarian hormones. So, at the very beginning of the cycle, we see that our low-frequency GnRH favors FSH. So our FSH is rising. That's going to favor follicular development and over time, the production of more and more estrogen, especially as we start to hone down to a single or a couple of very large secondary antral follicles. That estrogen is rising estrogen is going to help rebuild that uterine lining after its degradation, menses, due to loss of hormones that we'll see in just a moment. We also, as we mentioned previously, get that negative feedback of estrogen on FSH, helping to hone us down to a single dominant follicle. The rise in estrogen with the single dominant follicle will get a switch to positive feedback, and we get this enormous spike in the pituitary gonadotropins, especially the LH. The LH spike will initiate ovulation through the secretion of enzymes and inflammatory factors. We'll also see a transition in the follicular cells, there's actually less aromatase activity stimulated by that LH. And so we're going to get less estrogen, but we're going to start to produce more progesterone. We see that progesterone rising here, estrogen being a bit lower. Both of them are helping to maintain that uterine lining down here. The progesterone especially is supporting the mucus secretion that's going to aid implantation. If pregnancy does not occur, that corpus luteum will undergo a demise. It will degrade. We're going to lose those hormones that it's secreting. They'll fall off. Our negative feedback on FSH goes away, and so our FSH starts to rise. That's going to lead us right over to here, where FSH is rising and initiating a next follicular phase of the ovarian cycle that follows the first one. Now, because of the low ovarian hormones in this early stage of the follicular portion of the ovarian cycle, we lose our hormonal support of the uterine lining, and so we get this degradation you see here, the menses, this breakdown. And then as estrogen rises, as we said before, we're going to get a rebuilding, ovulation in the middle, and continues over and over again until pregnancy occurs. And then we sort of put a halt to all of this while the pregnancy is taking place.